Hello and welcome to Open Your Mind Radio. You have myself, Alan James.
And myself, Stephen George. Good evening.
Good evening. It's Sunday the 28th of February 2016 and we're back in the studio. Would you believe we haven't been live in the studio for at least 4 weeks?
Yes.
4 weeks.
Stop. You're too kind.
So my brother from another mother, the man who's sitting beside me, how are you? You did great last week. We're going to be talking about that anyway.
It was rough.
I know.
It was, yes. Anyway, less said about that.
Well, you rise to the challenge.
Yeah, we won't say rose to the challenge. It was okay. Sean kind of done all the work anyway. It was easy enough.
Good stuff.
You know, if I had been on with someone else who didn't really want to talk and I had to try and drag answers out of them, I would have been, well, let's just say there would have been a lot of music getting played that night.
Okay. Not to worry. Right, okay, our guests on, we're going to bring in our guests on in the next few minutes. Our guests are Dermot Murphy from the National Land League, and we were planning to have Byron on from the Hub, but Byron has the flu. I hope it's not the man flu. That's quite serious. We all know that. So instead of Byron coming on, we have Martina from the Hub. And Martina's going to tell us all about what's going on in the Hub and this so-called recovery that Enda Kenny keeps talking about. Or may I say what Donald Trump said, you know, my good friend over in America, over in Ireland, Eamon Kenny. And he said, did you see that tweet?
No, I don't tweet, I'm sorry.
Oh, no, I don't tweet. It was actually on Facebook where Donald Trump sent a tweet. He said, yeah, I'd like to wish my good friend in Ireland good luck, Eamon Kenny. You know, I'll come over when I'm president, he said. Right, okay.
Yeah, that'll be a long way away.
Yeah, it will be. Okay, now, before we crack on, let's find out what the communication channels are.
Yes, let's find out what the communication channels are. Mary.
The communication channels are email info@oymireland.com, by phone 046 927 1212, and you can also contact us direct through the OYM chat room.
Yes, 046 927 1212 is the phone number for the studio. If you're going to ring in from outside the Republic of Ireland, it's 00353 469271212. We also have the chat rooms. We're going to be monitoring those for questions this evening. That's the chat room on our own website, oymradio.com. You will see it there on the left-hand side. Log in with your real name or make yuppie and join in the chat and the festivities, and all drinks are half price. Yes. We also monitor the chat room on peoplesinternetradio.com as well. So a big hi to everyone in both of the chat rooms. You're all looking fantastic this evening. What else have we got? We have Facebook anti-social media is on the website as well. You will see it on our website, the little blue Facebook link. You can click on that and join us on the anti-social media and be real anti-social. We also have the YouTube link as well, which will bring you to the YouTube channel. You can watch some of the videos and the podcasts are up there. And we also have the TuneIn Radio Link application for your smartphone or your iPhone or your tablet or all sorts of devices, your PC and your laptop and all, everything's covered. So you can get us on the TuneIn Radio Link app as well. Just install that on your chosen device and go to the search and type in OYM Radio and you will find us there. Alan.
Excellent. As I just said, well done to Steve last week doing the show. I was away. I'm going to be talking about that later. And well done to Steve and his wife, BA, for taking care of the chat room. Well done on that.
She'll be delighted, she will.
She's done a great job there. And Steve was right. Steve did mention that, you know, I would be doing a lot of talking down on the course that we did down at Dingle, the Pain Genie course. And a lot of talking was done, totally. And nothing got to do with EastEnders or Carnation Street or anything like that. Great open-minded conversation. Hours of open-minded conversation, intellectual conversation. I'm going to be talking about that later on when we go to Alan's week. But it was definitely, you know, fantastic. A good weekend. As I say, I'll mention it later on. Now, I'm sure we all have election depression, because we're going to be talking to Dermot and Martina shortly about the election and also, you know, what they're doing as well. And myself and Steve had just been talking about it just before we went live about the election and, you know, people like Enda Kenny and John Burton and Alan Kelly being voted in. I mean, holy God, talk about Stockholm Syndrome in Ireland. I mean, there's people who just aren't getting it. I really, really don't understand. But look, we're going to talk about Dermot and Martina. We're going to talk to Dermot and Martina about that. Because it has to be said, it really does. I'm just shocked. I really, really am just shocked. It's unbelievable.
Yeah, well, look, as I said to you last night, as I said to you this evening, last night I was kind of passing attention to the results of the election, and I could just see Fine Gael climbing and climbing and climbing, and then Fianna Fáil were climbing, and I'm watching the thing in disbelief, and I'm saying, wow, have people learned absolutely nothing? And then I seen Ben Gilroy. I think Ben got didn't do very well at all. Neither did Alan Laws. And I mean, people who are familiar with you know, Ben Gilroy and DDI will they would know Alan Laws and Ben. And I'm very surprised at the low votes for those two in particular. But when I seen the what was it, Enda Kenny, when I seen him getting voted in, I says, ah, that's it. I stopped watching it then, and I walked away from it. And then my wife told me this morning that Joan Burton had got back in, and I was gobsmacked. And now you just told me Alan Kelly's after getting back in. I mean, wow, have the Irish people learned absolutely nothing? Or is it a case of, as I said to you, to Alan there just before we went live, have we not got enough of austerity? Is it a case of, you tried austerity, give us more, we want more of the same? I mean, it's either a case of, you know, we're being lied to, and, you know, maybe the voting was rigged, and we will get into that later. We're going to have an interesting chat with Dermot about that. But, yeah, I don't know. I mean, seriously.
Dermot was down watching the votes being counted, and he had an interesting observation on that. So we're going to talk to Dermot shortly about that. But, Steve, you're going to start us off with a few bits for the week.
A website, herfamily.ie, H-E-R, her. Herfamily.ie. Sammy, it's Erin Brockovich, and she's warning pregnant women against drinking Irish tap water. Now, look, this is an ongoing thing. We've had this debate going on over here for years and years and years. Even so far as one of the chaps that was in the election, Dermot Martin from Fianna Fáil, he's on record going back maybe 10 or more years saying that baby formula should not be made using the tap water in Ireland, because it kind of brought the fluoride levels up over what was deemed safe at the time in Europe. And now we have Erin Brockovich. She's still fighting the good fight, and now she's warning pregnant women against drinking the Irish tap water. Again, from what we've just seen last night with the elections, if it's a case of people are just, you know, I don't know, they're still asleep, then, or unawakened, or whatever you want to call them, then I think, Erin, you're wasting your time. Because they won't listen anyway. They're just going to keep on doing it because the government says it's safe. We're going to wish Erin Brockovich the best of luck with her campaign. I don't know if she's over here at the moment, is she?
I think she is planned to come over here. She's been asked to come over, yeah.
Yeah, I heard that she was supposed to be coming over, but I wasn't sure if it was, you know, if it was now, because I'm not keeping tabs on that. But listen, Erin, best, if you listen to this tonight, and I hope you are, best of luck. You're going to have an uphill struggle with the Irish people. People like us, we'll stand beside you, and we'll support you all the way. But I'm sorry, you're going to have an uphill struggle.
We did email Erin and asked her to come on the show, so we're just waiting on a reply. Hopefully we'll get that. Right, the SundayWorld.com had an article in it where they said a man was sentenced, was tripled for a role in Ireland's biggest cannabis growing facility. Now, I don't know whether this guy was growing the cannabis purely to sell it, or whether he was growing it for the benefit of people from a medical cannabis point of view. But, you know, considering most of the states in America are now legalizing it, Australia has legalized medical cannabis, and a number of European countries are doing the same thing. What's the chances of our Irish government legalizing it? Probably not a hope.
Slim to none.
Give them another 15 years. Maybe they kind of get the gist of it, you know. It's just so frustrating, it really is, that something like medical cannabis can cure cancer, and yet they won't do it. But then again, we know the control. That's the problem. Yeah.
Well, have you ever noticed, I'm guessing you would. You probably would have noticed, because I know I have, every so often, during the night time, it could be maybe 10 o'clock at night when it's dark, you'll often hear a helicopter flying around. Have you noticed that?
They're looking for the heat signature houses. Yeah,
that's exactly what they're doing.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I mean, again,
I switched mine off.
Oh, you can grow in a cold climate, can you? Fair play to you. But no, I mean, look, at the end of the day, people who are growing it, it's supply and demand, it really is. And I mean, if people are growing it, again, if it's, as Alan said, if it's for medicinal use for curing ailments, then, you know, I mean, and people are going to prison and having their sentence tripled for growing. I mean, okay, we don't know why he was growing it, but I mean, if he was growing it for a medicinal reason, well then, seriously, I know, isn't it one of the states in America where, you know, if you have it, is it five plants that you can grow? Is it five? And if it's over that, then it's considered, you know, you're supplying.
I believe Spain is six plants.
Oh, Spain.
Anything over six, then you're growing it for other people.
Yeah.
You're going to tell us about the Liberal.
I am. Theliberal.ie, the lovely Irish website there. A mother of five is recovering from cancer. And she's facing 3 days in prison because she cannot afford to pay €220 TV license, or a fine for not having a TV license. And all this while corrupt politicians and bankers are walking around free. It beggars belief. I mean, look, at the end of the day, we've been down this road as well. I can only assume when someone came knocking at our door, she capitulated with them, and that's how she ended up in this mess in the first place. It's like Laurel and Hardy, you know, how you got another fine mess you've got me into. But look, at the end of the day, if this woman, if she had just, you know, maybe done a little bit of research, then she could have got some information from the likes of OYM, the likes of PIR, or any of the other people out there who are advocating, you know, non-payment. But unfortunately, I mean, look, even at that, cancer, she's recovering from cancer, and they're prepared to send her for 3 days in prison. Well, I think, let's be honest about it, chances are she probably won't do 3 days. It'll be like what happened to the poor couple there a couple of years back, that she'd probably be driven from wherever she is residing all the way to the prison, which probably could, you know, it could cost a taxpayer a couple of €100. She'd be put in there for an hour, and then she'd be released and expected to pay her own way home.
Yeah.
You know,
I'd
say it'd be something like that. And we shall continue on.
Yeah, go ahead.
Right. KCLR96FM.com. That's a website there. I'm not familiar with it. But seemingly Labour Minister of State with responsibility for rural affairs and Carlo... Ah, there it is. It's Carlo Kilkenny election candidate. Anyway, the Carlo and Kilkenny election candidate running in the hope of retaining her seat this weekend was Labour's TD Anne Phelan, and seemingly she walked out of the KCLR studio during a live election debate while it was on air last night. Seemingly she's fed up with the whole bloody lot of you, and she left the debate. Now, I don't know, I didn't hear the debate, but I don't know, maybe she was getting a hard time, but I mean, at the end of the day, she was representing Labour, and actually I'm surprised she didn't get back in, seeing as though her colleague John Borton got back in, but yeah, she walked off the debate. God love her. You must have been asking some tough questions, were they?
Well, probably, yeah. What do you plan to do if you get elected?
Yeah.
You know, that's too tough. I can't answer that one.
Well, I'm going to feather my own nest. That's what I'm going to do. Yeah. And I'm going to do feck all.
I'm going to take care of myself and nobody else. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, how's your week?
Yes, I'm glad you asked. My week's been fine. It's a good week. Yes, it's good. It's good to be back to normality. Not too much. I don't want to take up too much time, but just two things on my little agenda. Trying to wake people up. I'm still harping on it that I'm woke. There was something written in one of the broadsheets, it was one of the tabloids, sorry, in relation to danger of carrying your phone in your pocket, and especially for men. So I've been floating that around work. I think I did mention that last week with Sean. Again, I've been saying it for years, no one pays a blind bit of notice, it suddenly turns up in the paper, and they kind of go, oh, it must be real now, because it's in the paper, you know. And anyway, grounding, anyone who hasn't heard about grounding, we discussed this before on the show, and there's a great film out there called Grounded. If you just search for it, I think it may be available on YouTube, I'm not sure, but Grounded, and it's talking about all the benefits of actually grounding yourself. And even walking barefoot in the garden, you know, stuff like that. It has amazing health benefits, and it's definitely worth checking out. So anyone who hasn't heard of that process, it's quite simple. Just check it out. Jump onto a search engine and just type in Grounding or Grounded, the movie. And just another movie that was on the agenda, Alan kind of put my way, was a film called Spotlight. And I watched that last night with my wife, and I have to say, it's all about the abuse in the Catholic Church and how it was covered up. And the film is powerful. It really is. It's Michael Keaton of Batman and other films. He's in it. He plays a blinder. And the whole cast is, you know, it's amazing what they found out and how they went about doing it. And it's, if you haven't seen it, check it out.
Based on a true story.
I wasn't sure, but at the end,
it was, yeah.
At the end, when all the credits were coming up, and I could see when they were talking about, you know, they kind of gave you a little synopsis of what has happened after the film and all this carry on. Like, I was kind of then saying, oh, it must have been based on a true story. But definitely worth watching. Again, that's called Spotlight. Michael Keaton is in that one. So if you haven't seen it, check it out. It's well worth seeing. Anyway, how was your week?
Well, I'm going to, before we bring in the guests, I just have to say a big thank you to everybody. You know, I was down away last week. I was down in Dingle doing the Pain Genie course. And on the Friday, we had a seminar, got to do with curing cancer naturally. Now, I did approach the chap who did the seminar, and he was more than happy to come on the show in a few weeks' time to talk about that. And that is it's going to be a great show, so, you know, tune in for that one. But I'd just like to say a big hello and thank you to everybody, because I enjoyed that company thoroughly. A big hello to Amanda. Amanda was my companion in the car on the way down. And she had to listen to me to get gabbling on for 4.5 hours down and 4.5 hours back.
God love her.
God love her. She needs a medal, right? And we just say hello to Jim and Catherine with a Y up from Scotland. And Anya and Neil and Niall and his wife, David and Lynn, Mary. There's a Lithuanian chap there with his girlfriend. And there's another lady there. Sorry, didn't get your name. And Gordon. And a big thank you to Christine for doing all the cooking. Fantastic food. Vegetarian food. And a big thank you for Richard for doing the course. Again, fantastic information. And it was, I will say, it was like self-catering, but it was a bit like Big Brother, you know? Like, Alan and Jim are in the kitchen, Mary's in the diary room, you know? it was a bit like that, you know?
Yeah. And vegetarian food, how'd you get on with that?
Yeah, it was okay. It was lovely. Yeah, it was
good. Not missed the meat, no?
No, it was cooked lovely, so I can't complain, you know? I did bring down some of the equipment that, thanks to our listeners for donating. The idea was to go down and do some, you know, recording. But there was guests that were supposed to be there that didn't turn up, so I didn't do the recording. So maybe the next time I'll do that. But brilliant weekend, great information about the Pain Genie. And, you know, if you are suffering, I mean, there's more and more people out there that have a Pain Genie. So if you are in pain in any way, get in contact with us and then we can sort you out either way or put you in touch with somebody. Because you shouldn't be in pain, not this day and age, with all the technology that's out there. Right, we're going to bring in our guests. Now, our two guests. The first guest is Dermot Murphy. Dermot is doing sterling work with the National Land League of Mullingar. And he's in and out of court more times than the judges, I think. He's always in there and he's helping so many people. And he's been doing it for such a long time. And really, really great guy. And I met Dermot personally, and we've met each other a few times going to National Land League meetings. Now, the other guest, Martina, we're supposed to have Byron on. Byron has the flu, so he couldn't make it, so he sends his apologies. But he's asked Martina, who also works, I won't say works, volunteers for the Hub, and is also in and out of court and doing sterling work in the High Court and helping people out. And we wanted to get Dermot and Martina on because we keep hearing about Enda Kenny saying the recovery. And the only thing I'm seeing that's being recovered are cars at the side of the road, because that's about it. I'm not seeing anything else. We're seeing more and more evictions. And now with the elections taking place and the same people getting in, I really, you know, switch off the light and close down the country, because, you know, what else can you do? But anyway, good evening, Dermot and Martina. How are you?
Great, no problems.
Brilliant. Great. Okay, Dermot, I'll just come to you first. If you want to kind of give us a quick bio, and just say, let people know, you know, I know you've been on the show before, but if you just want to tell people what you do, what you're volunteering and what you normally do as being part of the National Land League in the courts and stuff.
Well, what we do is we have the group called the West Meath Land League in Mullingar. There's about 60 of us all together in the group. And we go around different courts. We go to Tullamore, we go to Athlone, we go to Trim. And basically we just, anybody that's up there for eviction, we give them our number, and we'll also give them the Hub's number so they can get help. Because people don't understand. They think when they come to court, that's it. The hammer is going to be put down and you get an automatic eviction. But if you go to court and you say, I want to defend my home, I wish to, then it's automatically an adjournment straight away for a month or maybe 2 months, maybe 3 months. So you have 3 months in your home to come to us, and we'll do out your affidavit, or the Hub will do out your affidavit, and it'll keep you in your home. You know, but if you don't do that and people don't turn up, they just get evicted automatically. And basically what we're trying to do is to stop the suicides. I mean, they're just running out of control here in Ireland. Only 2 weeks ago, we had a guy in Cashel, and he pulled up on the bypass, and a lot of people seen this. They were there. Some of my friends were there. And he pulled up on the bypass in Cashel. He sent a text to his friend saying, can you tell my wife I'm very sorry for what I'm about to do? It's not her fault. I cannot take any more of the bank chasing me. And with that, he left the phone on the passenger seat and he just jumped out in front of a truck. Now, when we found out, a girl from Cashel phoned me that night and she said, Dermot, did you hear what happened? I said, no. And she told me what happened and I said, oh my God, are you sure? Because I just couldn't believe it. And the next day she went to see the, she actually knew this guy. He used to drive a digger for the council and that, you know. But she never knew he was in trouble with the courts because people don't like to say they're in trouble. And then she went to see the wife, and the wife said, she said to the wife, did you not tell him to phone the hub or Dermot, the landlady or somebody, the anti-eviction task force? And the wife said, who are they? So they didn't know who we were. So that's what we're trying to do, get around the courts. And we have a Westmead Land League meeting on every Friday. We have four or six people maybe who come in every Friday. And when we get overwhelmed, we put these people onto the hub because we can't tackle the amount of people. And if people think there's a recovery in Ireland, then they want to really go down to the hub in town and have a look every day of the week. There's 10 or 12 people there. I come to our clinic on a Friday and you'll really see what the recovery is about. There is no recovery here.
Yeah, no, it's incredible. And the work that you do and, you know, volunteering and all the people that's involved, it's fantastic, Dermot. And I'm sure there's hundreds of people that owe you some kind of debt of gratitude for what you do and to stop the suicides. And I'm speaking from experience when I say that because of a family member. So I understand, you know, where you're coming from and it's, you know, fair play to for what you're doing. I'll just go off to Martina. Martina, again, I know you work closely with Byron in the hub, and again, you're doing phenomenal work in the hub. Do you want to tell the listeners, you know, exactly what goes on and how many people are coming in and what you have to deal with?
Well, Dermot is correct when he says the desperation out there is just unbelievable. I mean, you get people ringing in, and at times, I'm not just saying it, but we are like a branch of the Samaritans. They've come to the end of the road. They don't know what to do. They've followed all the procedures that they thought they should follow. They've made arrangements with the banks. They've been living on beans and toast, not putting on the heating, paying outrageous amounts every month. And some of them will even put in, say, there was one lady who was the saddest of all, put in €60,000. She was left by a relative in a will. And the repossession order still came to her home. So you have this confusion, and the confusion is that you pay so much for so long and you don't understand that your arrears are shooting up and you think you're coming to a deal with the bank, but you're actually not. You're actually going into a trap. Then they send you out standard financial statements. People fill them in and they're grand for a while, and then they send you out more and they want more money. And basically, what we find is you actually walk yourself into what's known as an unsustainable mortgage, even though you didn't realise this when you were trying to come to a deal, you know?
Yeah.
So, like, when you get to that stage then, you know, you just, it's just dreadful to see. And Dermot hit on something very true as well, which is the shame. And there's no need for it because these are unusual times. You know, this is a very unusual thing in Ireland. There was an awful lot of money loaned out pre the global financial crash, and it was loaned out recklessly. And in many other countries, there actually is, you know, punishment for reckless lending. But over here, you're told it's reckless borrowing, which really it wasn't. You know, people just trying to better themselves, people being loaned money without proper protection, etc., 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 and then a crash which came, and we all know what happened then.
Well, I've heard this over and over again, Martina, and I wasn't in the country. I came back from the UK in 2005, so I wasn't here during the Celtic Tiger, but I spoke to Steve about it. Well, Steve, you can tell me, did you go and buy a second house in the Celtic Tiger? Did you see the Celtic Tiger?
And a third one, and a boat, and a stretch limo. No, there wasn't. I don't know where this Celtic Tiger came about. It didn't exist. Not for the common man. It was
it didn't exist. But what did happen was, and this is just my personal opinion and the opinion of a lot of people, it's like as if somebody came into the country and started. We've had people in who literally met people in car parks. Next day had 40,000 put into their bank account. I mean, that cannot be right.
No, well, that's like a loan shark.
They owe it to somebody else. Yeah, this is it. So some people borrowed off one bank and they were paying, you know, people who are not banks. That's the best way to put it, you know.
There's
huge confusion all around. You might have borrowed off John and now you owe Robert. You know what I mean? Like, and down the road you could owe somebody else.
Yeah, because when I come back in 2005, you know, I didn't know any of this information, by the way, at all. I was awake to the bigger picture, but I didn't know anything about the mortgages and the law and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And, you know, we kept seeing the government going, oh yeah, you better go get a property because if you don't, then, you know, you lose out and you won't. So we were kind of pressured. We felt pressured because I had a son that I had to get into school. I had to get get him into the school term. So we felt pressured that we had to go and get a property. And we were pressured by the social services as well, or the social department, the social welfare, to go and do it because they were going to cut any payment that we had. So it was all pressure on us to go and get a property at the time.
Well, after the crash happened, I remember listening to bankers actually admitting that they were paid commissions to push people to take money. They actually admitted it, that they were told, push, 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 push the money out there. You know, there was no protection. Now, if you lived in the UK, you're offered a thing called personal guarantee insurance. None of that was over here. Personal guarantee insurance means that you can't lose your own home. But people were signing up because they were told there's a Celtic Tiger. Do you remember the famous Bertie Ahern? Oh, anyone who doesn't believe it should go and commit suicide.
Yeah.
You know, this was talk at the time. And every corner you looked on, there was a house being built. You know, I actually knew a single mother with 7 children who got a loan to buy to build a 4-bedroom house on her father's corner, and subsequently lost it. You know, you have to ask who are these houses being kept for? Because that house is lying idle there. That's the other area of it, the mystery of where all the houses are being kept and why are they being kept.
Well, I'll tell you something. During the week before the elections, before obviously we got the results, Damien English actually knocked on my door, Steve. I don't know what
in person.
In person,
oh,
right?
Yeah, okay.
And he knocked on my door because he was obviously canvassing. And what happened was that when I said hello, he said hi. I'm Damien English, and I just burst out laughing, right? And then he started laughing because I was laughing, right? And so I said to him, well, first of all, I said, look, forget about the potholes and the schools. I said, what's the story with this odious debt? Well, he said, that's a national debt. And then I said, well, hang on a minute. I was going to go into the Glass-Steagall Act and everything else. And I said, well, what about fractional reserve banking? You know, and he just kind of said, well, okay, obviously not voting FG. So Fine Gael, so that was it, end of story, and off he went.
Yeah.
And he said, I'd like to come back to you and talk more about it. So I said, well, I'll tell you what, I've sent off an email to Damien English now to ask if I can go down to his constituent office and record an interview with him. Now, I got a read receipt on the email to say that he's received the email. Whether he asked me down or not, I don't know. But I want to start probing him about certain things.
Don't hold your breath.
I won't hold my breath. But it's just amazing that Damien English, being a TD and well-known in County Meath, actually thinks that the odious debt, number one, that we should be obviously paying it when we had no contract to, and the fact it's a national debt. Well, it's a national debt because they combined commercial debts with sovereign debt. That's the problem.
People are missing as well is it's impossible. I mean, people will never, an awful lot of people can never possibly pay back what they owed. They can't possibly pay it back. You know? So, like, it's even more disastrous because where are they going to go if they leave their house?
Yeah.
Where are they going to live? You know, it doesn't make sense.
Well, the banks don't care because they're a private company. As long as they get the property. Dermot,
we're becoming a corporate economy. I know exactly what you're saying because many of the big solicitor firms that are dealing with this, if you go onto their websites to look at what exactly they do, they're in the course putting people out of their homes, and then what they're doing is they are purchasing folios of homes and selling them on internationally.
Yeah.
So, you know, the way it seems to me and to a lot of people I know, is that we will become a rental economy. Now, that's all very well. Like, I have a son, 26 myself, he doesn't mind renting, but not renting for 2,000 a month, unsustainable renting. We don't have any rent controls, we don't have any rental safety. I mean, if you think as well, an awful lot of the apartments and homes that were built were substandard because of dodgy planning, you know, brown envelopes, the whole lot.
Yeah.
And people are so desperate for a home, they're paying over the odds to stay in a lot of these dumps. So it's a country to just make money out of, you know, and the people are suffering.
I can definitely say that. I mean, the people who built my house were definitely blindfolded or trained by Stevie Wonder, because... And I've nothing against Stevie Wonder, but that's how I feel. Dermot, you want to come in there?
Yeah, and you were talking about the debt, the odious debts. That actual debt has nothing got to do with the public. It's nothing got to do with it. It's a regime's debt. It's a debt that belongs to bondholders.
Yeah.
And if anybody has a pen there, they can write down the concept of odious debt in public international law. And if you Google that and have a look, I think it's page 7 or 8, it clearly states that the debt is the debt of the regime. It's not a public debt. It's not belong to the public. And any government, and it says this in the document, any government that tries to enforce this debt on the public should be removed from office. It states that clearly. Now, if you remember when this debt was signed in, it was signed in at 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock in the morning. And there was 40 of us outside the Dáil that night with a petition for the president not to sign the odious debt until the court case the next day. The court case was the next day at 10:30. And if we had got the court the next day, it would have been adjourned because we would have produced this document. It's called the Concept of Odious Debt in International Public Law. And this would have been produced to the court and the truth would have been found out and we would have never had to pay it. And that's where they rushed it. When we had the petition there for the president up in the park got the wind that we had the petition there and they took the papers up to the park for him to sign up there. We couldn't get the petition to him. And then about 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock in the morning, the politicians from all the parties staggered out of there, absolutely pissed out our minds. And they hadn't got a clue. We found out afterwards, we spoke to a few of them. They had not got a clue what they had signed that night. It was like a telephone book, and they had 20 minutes to read through it and to say yes or no. And that's what's wrong with this whip system in this country. Once Ed McKenney or whoever it was signed yes, all his party had to follow suit. And the same with Labour. Once the head phoned or just said yes, they all had to follow suit. That debt is never our debt. It never was, it never will be. And that's what's caused all the problems, paying that $8 billion every month, you know. And here we have today, I just see that Goldman Sachs, the very people that we bailed out with this money, are at the buying of $750 million worth of mortgages now again. And they're going to come after these people in the courts as well, the tribunal.
That's it. Well, I kind of tend to call Goldman Sachs Goldman Sucks. Because obviously what they're doing. Now, the Glass-Steagall Act, just for a reminder for people, and my understanding of it is that in the 1929 stock market crash, they actually lumped in sovereign debt with commercial debt. And the whole idea of the Glass-Steagall Act was to separate the both of them so that wouldn't happen again. But in 1999, Bill Clinton signed it back in. So, and that's why what happened in 2008... happened. And they're saying now, obviously, the banking system is going to collapse again because the derivatives market is worth, see, it was worth $60 trillion in 2008 and it's now worth $700 trillion and it just can't be sustained. It's a Ponzi system that's going to crash. And if you look at all the financial experts, they're talking about it. The whole system's going to come down. When, I don't know. I think it's inevitable. When it's going to come down, I don't know. Because there's a lot going on. But, Martina, tell us, obviously we're going to talk about the election and what went on because, you know, it's definitely Stockholm Syndrome for Ireland again.
Yeah.
And everybody there. Why not talk about it now? What's your take on what went on with the election? I mean, I know there's still counting, but.
Well, I think, it's like everything else. Irish people are full of fear. And they're in a bad way already. You know the old saying, the devil you know better than the devil you don't know.
Yeah.
And if you take the average person of a certain age turning on RTE every night, TV3, UTV, I mean, who were the politicians that were coming in from the screen to every night? The same old, promising the world. And, you know, they have it well stratified because there's the few I'm all right jacks. And the way that they deal with them is they tell them, well, I mean, if people borrowed the money, they have to pay it back. And that seems logical to most people. But what they're not telling them is, just correctly, as Dermot said, It's not their it's not our debt. It's bondholder debt. But the picture that's been put out there is very different, you know?
Yeah.
How do you get that out to the public when the public are listening to the likes of RTE and all the usual, you know, media stations and that? Like, you know, it's been drilled into their heads all the time. There's a recovery going on. There's a recovery going on. And I just think we're a nation of fear.
Yeah. You know? Well, is it fear or is it a nation of ignorance?
No, I think it's actual fear. I really do. Afraid for change. Afraid to give somebody else a chance. And also, as well as that, the people who vote just really are mostly our older people. And all they've ever known is the two parties, Fianna Fáil and Fianna Gael. When you look back, maybe Labour thrown in here and there, you know?
Yeah.
I think they're just afraid, which is an awful shame. But I also think that if you looked at the campaign coming through, everybody was mentioning homelessness. Everybody was mentioning water. Water and homelessness were high on the agenda. But nobody was really mentioning evictions, and nobody was mentioning the bank debts, the mortgage crisis, the mortgages in arrears, 95,000 plus what we know of. So nobody is mentioning this, you see. And, like, it just makes no sense either, because this is what's causing homelessness. Even people who became accidental landlords, they're losing their homes, or their you know, what they bought as their pensions, let's say, because they can't afford to sustain them. So their tenants are getting thrown out as well. So, like, the root of the problem was never being put out there. All that was being put out there was, you know, just there's homeless people and there's 1,500 children in hospitals, etc., etc. So they didn't really put a clear picture out there.
That's the illusion they create with certain people.
They need to change the name of homelessness to displaced people, because a lot of people are not actually homeless. They may not live in a home, but they're in accommodation, which is not acceptable either. But they are displaced people, and they're the people you're not seeing lying on the streets. Thank God. You know, so it's displaced people.
I just don't know how people can't see it, but they must be in a cocoon or a world of their own. Dermot, what's your take on the election? And tell us what you said to me before we went live, what you've seen happen in the voting.
Well, I'd be put down as a conspiracy theorist again, but every conspiracy theory that I've brought out in the last 4 or 5 years, funny enough, every one of them has come through, you know. But I was in the Kell Centre the other day up in Ashbourne, and I was only about 18 inches from the girl taking them out of the boxes, lying them flat for us to see who voted. And after about 20 minutes looking at it, I was just taking tallies for Ben Gilroy, seeing what he got. And after about 10 minutes looking at this, I noticed a prominent Fine Gael girl politician up in the area. And some of the papers that were coming out just had number one on it, for her. There was no number two, number three, number four, nothing. Just number one, for her. And then I noticed another couple came out, and then there was another number one for her. And then I said, that's a bit odd. But about 80 or 90 of these came out with the same number one. No number two, no number three, nothing else, just number one. And I thought to myself, that's a bit odd. And every one of these that was written down, the number one, looked the same. It looked like it was sloped to the right a little bit, but it looked like the same person had written all of these. Now, it could be a conspiracy, maybe not. But I want to know is why do they have to have the boxes overnight? Why can't they just do the voting and start counting the same day like you do in England, you know? Why did they have to have them overnight with a little plastic tie wrap that can be just taken off and you can put another one back on? I just find it very suspicious. I really do, especially after seeing Kenny getting back in and Alan Kelly when it's on the fifth count, you know?
Yeah,
I find it very, very suspicious, and I want to know why are they holding them overnight, you know?
Now, apparently, to make it all kind of legal and above board, isn't there supposed to be a Gardaí at the polling booths, at the counting, or so to make sure there's nothing dodgy going on?
Yeah, but there was no Gardaí. They weren't visible this time.
Oh, that's why they were arresting Irish water protesters. That's why they weren't there.
But, like, England has, like, 60 million people, and they do the voting there, they start counting straight away. You don't hold them overnight.
Yeah, but, Dermot, you know the Irish mentality. We like our cup of tea and a sandwich and a bit of a sleep, you know. The fact that our country is being destroyed doesn't come into it, you know. We do like our little bit of, you know. It's like what annoys me a lot of the time, and maybe I'm being cynical, right, is because, you know, we're in a mass austerity. Businesses are closing down left, right and centre. But yet, when you go to some shops, they're closed between 1 o'clock and 2 o'clock. Oh, sure, I have to have my sandwich and my cup of tea.
That's a siesta. That's the weather. The clouds have the heat, you know.
Yeah, of course,
but
yeah.
But anyway, what really gets on my nerves is, well, you hear people running down the hub and the Westmead Land League and Ben Gilroy, and some of these people have never met him. So even if there's any listeners there listening, if you're running down the hub on yourself or anybody else, first come and see what we're doing. Have a look at what we're doing. Go to the hub. Sit there for a few hours in the hub and watch what they do. And I tell you, it's a real eye-opener when you go into the hub and see what them people do. And these people do this for free. I do this for free. I sit there with people on a Friday afternoon and help them with their affidavits. I don't charge anything for it. And that's what we're doing tomorrow. We have the Mullingar in the GAA club are going to have evictions in Mullingar, you know. And I have a huge big sign made up. And on the sign it says, we can help you. This service is free. Don't turn a debt into a D-E-A-T-H. Don't turn a debt into a debt. And the hub is mentioned on it, the Westmead Land League, the Anti-Eviction Task Force, and all these numbers can be contacted and are free to help. And we're just trying to get the message out to people that there is help there. But it's the Irish way. Pull the curtains. Don't, when the mail comes in, the letterbox is thrown in the bin. It won't happen to me.
Yeah.
But it will happen to you. If you don't keep in contact with the bank, start asking the questions, start dealing with them, negotiating with them, you will get evicted. They'll just throw you out, you know?
And you have to be on the ball. No argument was ever sorted by not talking. And you have to set up a line of communication with the banks. Now, my heart went out to Ben because I know Ben put his heart and soul into the election, as did Adam Laws and a few of the other people that we know who've been on the show as well. And
yeah, but it's no money, you see. What happened there was I live in Mullingar and I drove up to Navan and up around there every day, putting up posters for Ben, going outside the stores and you've been canvassing for Ben every day, but there was only 12 of us. 12 of us in the whole area for Ben, helping him out, you know?
Yeah.
And like the last time when we had the local elections for Ben, we had over 150 people helping out, canvassing, going around the doors, and he beat Labour that time. But this time, for some reason, we'd only 12, and I really feel sorry for Ben, because he worked really hard.
I know he did, yeah, and he felt very kind of dejected, I suppose, because just, you know, the amount of effort and work that he's put into it and the work he's actually still doing, going to High Court and helping people out. And yet people don't see that kind of side,
no,
really.
And if you listen to other people there, so-and-so said that Ben Gilroy is a snake salesman. And they think, oh, geez, he's a bad guy. But just do yourself a favour and just go down to the hub or come into the Westmead Land League of a Friday, come into one of our meetings and have a look what we do first before you judge us.
Yeah. Well, see, that's the trouble with some people, Dermot. They listen to somebody else's opinion of a person and you don't say, well, I don't know that person, so I'm going to sit in the fence and wait till I meet this person, then I'll make my own judgment. They just go with what somebody else has said.
I had a guy only a few, I think I was telling you a few months ago, and he came on to me inbox and he said, oh, that Ben Gilroy is only a snake and all this. And I said, who told you that? And he mentioned the guy's name, so-and-so. So I clicked the man's name in and I looked up. He was on my friends list. So I went into his inbox and I said, where did you hear that Ben done this or the other? And it took me an hour, and I traced it to 8 different people that had never met Ben, and I still couldn't find the source of who had started it, you know?
Yeah.
All bullshit. Listen to so-and-so said this. I mean, I'll give you an example. 2 years ago, Martina will probably remember this, or Byron if they're listening. A guy in Mullingar sent me an inbox, and he's well-known, gobshite he is anyway, and he said, oh, look what I have on the hub, Dermot. We have a quarter of a million in that account, you know? And I said, I texted him back, and I said, hey, where did you hear that? I said, because I was up in the hub yesterday, I said, I broke. Oh, no, I have to, from a reliable source, they have a quarter of a million. They're having people over, they're conning people, you know. So I said, listen, don't put anything out on Facebook. I said, I'm going up to the hub tomorrow, and I'll have a word with Byron about this. And I did, Byron will tell you. And Byron laughed his head off. He said, a quarter of a million. And up on the wall was the accounts from the bank. He said, there, Dermot, that's what's in our account. He'd €800 in their account. And he said, oh, Dermot, that could be gone this week, because there's someone that's at €210 a week. I mean, 4 or 5 someone to do this week. But that's the type of gobshittery that goes on here. And when I came back home and text that guy, I said, and I gave him a photo, I took a photo with the thing, I said, there's what they have in their account. Oh, well, Jesus, that was a reliable source I had. I said, well, there you go. You're prepared to put all that up on Facebook and discredit the hub because of some wanker told you, you know?
Yeah, I know.
But that's what's happening.
I know, but and that's the problem. I mean, people are too, I don't know whether it's naivety or whatever it is, but that they actually believe what other people are saying rather than saying, well, show me the facts. I'm not, you know, it's all hearsay. As we all know, hearsay is inadmissible in court. Show me the facts.
Yeah.
Martina.
Yeah, I mean, you get those people all the time, begrudgers, I call them. Or maybe they have a different agenda. You don't know that either. Because it seems to bother them a lot that, you know, ordinary people are just helping ordinary people.
Well,
so we just tend to ignore them.
That's the way we're going to solve it, Dermot and Martina. That's the way. It's going to be people power. We can't rely on the government. Steve, I want to get your take on the election side of things. What's been happening now in your area and what's your take?
Yeah, well, look, again in our area, I just want to mention, sorry, real quick, that we did say something about all the parties were talking about all different things, but they weren't talking about the eviction problem. Well, actually, and I just wanted to say that it was brought up to my attention, and I think we all knew anyway, that DDI were highlighting the eviction problem. I've seen some of Ben's policies.
Oh, yeah. But I should have made it clear. I mean, you know, the ones who are getting themselves out there on the RTE and the Irish stations and that. It wasn't mentioned anywhere. It was homelessness was mentioned. All that type of stuff, but about actual, you know, mortgages in crisis wasn't being mentioned at all. The only one mention I saw of it was on RTE News, which I sent in a complaint about the blondie one, I can't remember her name, who reads the news, and she made a kind of a horrible comment. I think it was Sinn Féin said they'd deal with it, or they'd do something with it, and she said, oh, that means anyone can then draw down a mortgage, pay off a few payments and then just sit back pretty, you know? So that's the attitude that you get.
Yeah, well, look, so at the end of the day, anyone who's in the know, we all know that, you know, RTE will say mass
absolutely.
Anyway.
But again, getting back to the point, this is what people watch and believe and look at each other and go, oh, you know? And, like, she had no business saying it because she's supposed to be totally impartial. Her job is to read the news on her huge, big public payment, you know?
Yeah. It's the same with Brian Dobson. Brian Dobson, I've watched him over the years. And, I mean, Brian Dobson came from Pirate Radio. And he was a great man when he was on the Pirate Radio. But I've noticed over the years of kind of watching Brian's career that he's been groomed, if you want a better word, by mainstream.
Yeah.
And even he would never miss an opportunity to run down or stick the boot in with the likes of the Alternatives. I mean, he's happy enough to give plenty of airtime to the likes of the Fine Gaels, the Fianna Fáils.
Yeah. I mean, absolutely. They're totally politicised. They don't care what anybody says.
And I know Benoit had a couple of radio interviews as well during the week, and I listened to them. And again, LMFM, and there's another radio station he did. And again, they went under attack with Ben. And the trouble is that these DJs, I'm not saying myself and Steve, you know, we're under no illusion that we know everything, and we're learning as much as every time we
absolutely
get a guest on, we're learning from it.
Yeah.
But I just hear the arrogance of these DJs. How can you argue with somebody about what fractional reserve banking is if they don't have a clue what it is?
Well, you're not going to hear about that on any of the normal airwaves, you know, because it won't be brought up. That might get people thinking, you know.
Well, I don't know whether Steve, were you with me that time down in Kells? I don't think you came down with me. There was 50 people and they were talking about homelessness down in Kells. Long story, but basically, they were saying, oh yeah, what about the solution of selling your house back to the bank and paying rent and all that? And I stood up and said, you know, I said, that's ridiculous. I said, is there anybody in this room that understands fractional reserve banking? And about 3 people out of 50 put their hand up. And I said, that's the problem. I said, you guys don't know what's going on. That's why the politicians and the banks are running rings around you, because you don't understand how the system works.
Correct.
You have to have 25% liquidity in the bank when they're giving out loans.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's what they're supposed to have. So if they're giving out 200 billion in loans, you have to have 25% of that in cash in the bank. And we never had that. They were giving out billions and billions worth of loans. I think Ulster Bank had 100,000 in their account at the 1 year we got a record of. And they were giving out hundreds of millions worth of loans. And you can't do that. Well, that's against the law.
Well, there was a gold standard in the 1970s which was taken away, and this is where the banks went mad. It happened in Iceland where they actually had a ratio of 1 to 2 or 1 to 3 or whatever the ratio was, and then when they took away the actual the standards, their GP,
GDP.
GDP went from 20 billion to 120 billion. And that's what happened in Iceland. And then obviously we know the story with Iceland. We had Brigida Jón's daughter on the show telling us what happened there. And
yeah, how they got their... You never let the news out about Iceland to us.
Well, no, this is why we got Brigida on, because she told us what happened over there. We got it straight from the horse's mouth from Brigida, because there's loads of stories about what happened. And we asked her to come on, she's an Icelandic politician. And she came on the show and told us what happened in Iceland. And now they're on the up. And lucky enough, they have their own currency. But over here at the moment with Ireland, and, you know, I mean, the British exit from Europe, I don't know what's happening there. I think that's a game as well. I think there's a game going on there, you know. And again, will Ireland get affected by that if the UK pull out of Europe? I don't really know what's going to happen there. You know, well, I was going to say to Steve, going back to what I said earlier, Steve, with the election, what's your take on the election?
Well, look, my take on the election is that the whole thing was rigged from start to finish. That's what I honestly believe. I seen all the posters, like everyone else, you've seen all the posters, vote for me, I'm going to do this, that and the other. I think it was a waste of money, because the way I feel, honestly, is that the whole thing was rigged. It stinks to high heaven. I believe that, especially what Dermot said there in relation to the counting that goes on, as soon as the polls are closed, it should be counted straight away. And even at that then, there's probably room for error there as well. However, less error than leaving the boxes lying in a counting centre overnight, you know, where anyone can come in. Well, I'm guessing anyone who in the know can come in and put a 1,000 votes in for, you know, Fine Gael candidate, Fine Gael candidate. At the end of the day, it was either rigged or the Irish people haven't learned, and as I said earlier, they want more austerity. We can't get enough of it, which I don't believe that. I don't believe that the Irish people want more of the same. I think it was rigged. At the end of the day, even coming up to the election, the amount of canvassers that were going around, I didn't see Damien English. We actually got on a couple of days before the election, we got ballot sheets posted in the door. From Damien English. It was a sample ballot sheet, but it was the actual photocopy of the actual ballot sheet. Did you get it?
Yeah.
And Damien English had him as number one, someone else number two, and someone else number three.
NLP. Telling people
NLP. Well, I seen that when I came home, and I got a black marker, and I wrote across it. I'm not going to say what I wrote across it, because it's fairly descriptive, and it went back into an envelope, and it was posted back to Damien English. But you're right, it is NLP. He's trying to influence people, but he didn't have the audacity to knock on our door. He knocked on your door.
Yeah.
The only person who actually knocked on our door in the flesh was Pater Tobin, or Pater Tobin. I'm not sure exactly what the pronunciation is. He's the only one that knocked. A couple of other people knocked, representing, you know, Shane Castles or whoever the hell it was. And my missus, she was there, and she opened the door and she spoke to these people, and she said, what has Shane Castles ever done for where we live, our village? And the young man says, oh, well, he'll do this, that and the other. And she said, no, what has he done? Oh, well, he done this for Delvin. And she goes, no, that's not what I'm asking. I'm asking about this town. What has he ever done? What would you like him to do? And she says, well, knock on the bloody door for a start himself, instead of sending his lackeys round. And again, the words were passing.
He did knock on my door, I have to say, Castles.
Did
and,
he?
Yeah. And as soon
you
as...
You must be special.
I'll tell you, I am. Seriously. I am. My mum always said I was special.
she's right.
And he did knock on the door.
Yeah.
And, as soon as he realised that I wasn't going to vote Fianna Fáil, he was like a greyhound out of a trap, you know. Boom! Yeah. He was right out the door, into the next door, knocking on the door. You know, it's unbelievable. And I didn't have Pádraig Tobin, but I had a Sinn Féin support to knock on the door. And the first thing he said was, oh, we're going to get the roads fixed. And I said, the roads? I said, you think that's the major problem on my mind is the roads? With evictions and suicides and what's going on with the banking system? and you're telling me that you're going to fix potholes in the roads. And I'm thinking, is this the way they think the Irish people are?
No, it's not.
I can give you a better one than that. I had a representative for Richard Bruton that come out here, and I brought up the bank situation and the mortgages in arrears. And I also said to him, are you aware of rateable value? Now, rateable value is a thing that Byron came across from the hub, that they were taking homes into court under the jurisdiction of rateable value. And yet there has been no rates in Ireland on domestic properties since 1977, only on commercial properties. But they're still going ahead with the repossession, even though they've been told about it. So I asked him, I said, have you heard of rateable value? He said, yes, of course I have. And I said, you know, it's gone now since 1977. And he said, what difference does that make? The people borrowed the money, they have to pay it back. And I said, it was reckless lending. And he said, no, it was reckless borrowing. And I said, how many bankers are in jail or have lost their houses? He said, that's nothing got to do with anything, he said. If you borrow the money, you owe the money. And that was his complete attitude the whole way through. So they know what's going on, and they just don't care.
Well, here's the question. Did you borrow the money? Did these people physically see the money?
No, but the thing about it is, that's the attitude, and that's the way they...
I totally agree. Well, that's the arrogance of them, I know.
Absolutely. Yeah. But here's the more sickening part. He topped the poll, you know?
It's unbelievable, isn't it? Dermot, you want to come in there?
Yeah.
But you say 25% of CDs are landlords, so it's a sore subject with them.
Yeah.
They don't just start the barrel.
Yeah.
No, seriously, since I've come back from the UK, I left the UK in 1988 because of mass unemployment and everything else. And I have to say, I did well in the UK, you know, from a job and career-wise, and I decided, right, time to come back to Ireland. Boy, that now, I feel, in hindsight, was a bad mistake because Ireland's just got worse. And it hasn't changed. You would think it would improve over time, but it's still the same country. It's still people doing padded envelopes, backhanders, corruption. You know, I mean, it's unbelievable. And people still accept it. I mean, are we a country full of I'm okay jacks?
I don't know, because, like, if you look back at the so-called fight for equality, the gay marriage referendum, my God, it was an absolute party going on in town, and it was vote yes everywhere, and people were jumping up and down. And yet when it comes to suffering and human misery, equality doesn't seem to have the same, you know, sympathy from the general public out there. It's a strange one, you know?
Yeah. It is a strange one. And
isn't it?
Yeah. And it's amazing.
We had Andy down in the panty bar, but yet he wouldn't be standing in a bank or in a court with somebody whose husband or wife has committed suicide over being evicted, or the fear of eviction and all that, you know. It's just all wrong.
That would have been one of my questions if Damon English stayed around, was when did you last go down to Trim Court to support somebody being evicted? And chances are, I probably would have said, I've never been down there.
No.
You know, and this is the thing with the politicians. I really don't know. I'd like to get into the psyche, but maybe it's down to a lack of knowledge, because ignorance, I know that sounds very abrasive, but there's a difference between ignorance and nescience. And ignorance being, you know, you're on the train track and you can hear the train coming, but you still ignore the train because you're ignoring it. Ignorance, where nescience
I
is just not knowing.
I think it was John Burton who changed where you had to put on the certificate, the death certificate, death by suicide. I don't think you have to put that on anymore. So therefore, trying to gauge official statistics now is even harder. So you'd wonder, you know?
Well, there's 9,000 suicides since the crash. Like, but that, you won't get that out in the media.
You won't get it out in the media, but also they've changed the law where you don't have to. And even, I believe the... the guy, what would you call him, in the morgue at the time, he was annoyed about it because he felt it was wrong.
It is probably wrong. If it's suicide, it's strictly from the death cert as suicide. Because you don't want it for the future history on their watch, that all these suicides happen in their power.
That's why I suggested
to people that they should go down, just take a bit of time out of their day and walk into the hub for a few hours and have a look at the real recovery that's happening in Ireland. I come to our clinic on a Friday and look what's really around the court. You don't see an RTE, 80 cases tomorrow in Mullingar Corridor, 100 cases in Tullamore on Tuesday. You won't see any of this in the media.
No, it's
but
not.
But you see evictions already, there's a person evicted. We had
our Kira, she was on Evicted at Christmas on the documentary, and she was the face of, you know, a woman who's on her own, a single mother, rearing her son, losing her home, working night and day. She's fighting against the wind all the time because she's damned if she does and she's damned if she doesn't. But then by the same contrast, you had a programme on RTE about, you know, homeless people. And, you know, miracle of miracles, one of the couples, thank God now, with kids, got a council house. Now, that would be just unbelievable in this day and age. But you can see the spin that goes out there, you know.
Definitely.
So anybody watching that would have thought, oh, that's great, you'll get a council house. And we find a lot of that with people. They ring in, they say, look, maybe I should just hand the house back, I'll get a council house. And we say, well, if you can get a council house, I'll tell you.
Well,
Martina
and Dermot, you might be able to clarify this for me. I heard through the grapevine, and this was from a solicitor, that if you volunteer your house, you're not entitled to get any accommodation. But if they actually take the house off you, they're legally entitled to find you accommodation.
Yeah, if you're homeless,
yeah.
You have to be evicted first. Once you get evicted, then the council, you're the responsibility of the council then. But you see, I had a guy in 2 weeks ago into our clinic in Mullingar, I won't give you his name. And this guy was paying €1,400 a month. Every penny that he had, you know. Every month for the last 11 or 12 months, he's continually paid every month. And he got a letter to start mortgages because he owes, I think, 20,000 in arrears. And they're going to take it to court and they're going to get an eviction order because he feels that he cannot pay this 20,000 arrears in a 12-month period. So I wrote back a letter for him saying, can you extend this arrears period to 3 years? And he wanted to pay the arrears. He was willing to pay it. But that's what I'm saying to people who engage with the banks. And once he goes into court and shows this letter to the judge that he's paying $1,400 and he wishes to address his arrears problem, no judge in the country will evict him, you know?
Yeah, well, this is what we've always said. The trouble is a lot of people get into problems and they get letters from the bank and the first thing they do is they bury their head in the sand. And that's the last thing you have to do.
No. Yeah, but unfortunately, Dermot, I have to come in another angle as well. There is people sometimes who do all what you're saying, and they still get repossessed.
Why not?
They can never, ever pay back the money because maybe they lost their job or something happened along the way. And the debt, it's like the bank wants the house. That's the only way I can say it. The bank wants the house, and they don't. I've heard more people say in court, the bank would not engage me. I rang them, I said I'd pay this, I said I'd pay that, and they don't even know how they ended up there in the end. So there is that as well.
Yeah, it's an asset grab. They're out to get the houses.
It's a land grab, you know.
Yeah, and I think, Martina, what people will have to understand, because I hear this time and time again, and I'm sure you do as well, well, why don't they offer some money to the bank? Surely it's better to have people in the house than not. Not realising that it's based on the fractional reserve banking system, that the bank didn't, they took the money out of fresh air and gave it to them. So as you're saying, it's a property land grab, and that's why the banks don't care.
That's it, yeah. And don't forget, if we become a rental capital of Europe, happy days for landlords. You know what I mean? Like, charge what you want. You know?
Well, now, funny enough, in Europe now, I've done a lot of travelling in Europe, and Ireland and the UK are quite unique, because over in Europe, people don't really buy their property, they rent.
That's absolutely fine, because they rent at a livable rent. But nobody could afford to be paying 600 and 700 a month in this country.
Yeah.
Don't forget about our zero contract hours, our jobs that are part-time, and, you know, we're not, you know, so we can't really sustain that house for mortgage.
Yeah, true. I mean, that's a good point. So there should be a cap on rents, really, to control that market.
Well, like, there's no way that you should be paying, you know, 1700 a month for a box and rearing three children in it. Nobody monitors how many. I know somebody who lives in a one-bedroom department, and next door to them in another one-bedroom department for 1,200 a month is a couple and three children, and that's one bedroom. Now, that's a private rental apartment, but nobody is watching that angle either.
Yeah.
If they wouldn't be allowed to put people into council property with just one bedroom and three children, do you know what I mean? So there's all that going on in the background as well.
And there's loads of houses available. I mean, where I live in the estate that I'm in, I could probably point seven houses that are empty that could possibly be used.
They're probably being kept, you see, to be rented out eventually.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
That's a whole other program.
it's just madness, isn't it? We're going to go over to Steve. Steve, do you have any questions?
I do. I have a comment that came in from Vin, and I have to say it makes perfect sense. And maybe Martina and Dermot, you can comment on this. But Vin says, if people were to use the constitutional article 4.5, there would be no eviction. He says, he also goes on to say, people are not being evicted. They are mistakenly abandoning the constitution and walking out of their homes. What do you think of that?
Yeah. That's, again, that's fear as well. One of the saddest cases I ever heard was a lady who rang in, and she was engaging with a so-called government agency to come to an agreement about how much she could pay, blah, 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 blah. Anyhow, it didn't work out in the end. She couldn't sustain it. She was never going to be able to. So a lady from this governmental agency rang her on one of the days, and she said to her, well, look, as you've come to the end of the line now, if I were you, I'd pack up the stuff. You don't want the children upset by the guards coming to the house to put you out. So what do you do, you know? And thank God she came to us, and she got to know what's what and the whole lot. But how many others have just left their house, like you say.
Exactly.
Another misconception, we get a lot of people in, the minute they get a letter from the bank to say a repossession order, they are crippled with fear that a sheriff is going to knock on their door any time of the day or night. So if anybody is listening and is afraid of that, it doesn't happen like that. No. They have to give you notice, and there's a long, long, long road down towards that.
And letting them know about the constitution, this particular article? I mean, I guess you're educating them on that.
Oh yeah, well here's another thing as well that people don't realise. If you have children over 18 in the house, they cannot be evicted. It's their family home and they are not on the mortgage. It's as simple as that.
All right, Dermot, you want to come in there?
Yeah, I was saying, I just noticed going around the courts, I've been going around the courts for a few years now, and last week I was in Athlone Court, and another insolvency agency is springing up now. Uh-huh. And I said to the girl, she had boxes of literature and all this, that, and the other, a minimum fee of €1,000. And I said to her, who do you work for? Such and such a company. And she gave me a list of all these new companies. And there's hundreds of them, 150 of them have started up around Ireland, insolvency practitioners. It's huge money. And I said to her, do you realise that these people that are before these courts today are before these courts because they have no money, they can't pay their mortgages. How do you expect them to get €1,000 to give you? Oh, well, we do terms and conditions and this, that and the other. This is a huge money-making exercise.
Oh,
That's incredible. Do you have something else there, Steve, you want to jump in on?
I just want to mention Chris asked me just to say to Martina and to Dermot and all at the Hub, he said he wants to say a big thank you to you all for your great information and your help. He says you're truly wonderful people, and I'm guessing obviously a lot of people who have come through across your paths and through the doors of the Hub will probably feel the same way. And I just wanted to mention that because Chris said it, and you know it's probably something that you don't think, well, you maybe do hear it very often, I don't know.
It's always an absolute pleasure. I've never had a bad experience. And that's
brilliant.
I'm sure, Dermot, you're the same. It's an absolute
pleasure. There's no greater feeling than helping somebody up off the ground. Yeah. You know, there's nothing to gain from it, but you make these people feel good about themselves, you know?
I totally agree. We are always promoting service to others and helping people. And in OIM, myself and Steve, away from the radio show, we do our bit, what we can do, and it's a good feeling, and it just feels good helping people, when there's an issue and you're dealing with it. But something I want to put out there as well, and for people who don't know about this, and Martina and Dermot, maybe you can comment on this as well. Apparently the banks are getting very blasé, and instead of actually going to court and getting an order, they're just sending the letter out, taking a chance that if they say you're going to be evicted, that people will just get out of the house. And they illegally, well, they're required to go to the court and get a court order before they do that. But I know it's been said that some banks are just sending the letters out just to kind of see if they can fear, put people in fear and get them to move out easily.
Yeah, that's called the 7-day letter, get out of the house.
Yeah.
And people do think that, but no. That's way before. You have to be served a civil bill first, and that's usually comes through the registered post. You have to be served at all. There's a huge long process. You don't panic at that stage. Get in touch with either ourselves or Dermot.
You see, the banks try this avenue because if they send out a 7-day letter and somebody walks in and hands in their case, that saves them huge amounts of legal fees.
Of course, yeah.
Because what the banks get and what people don't realise, and RTE should be spreading this out, the barristers for the banks get around 70,000 from the start of the case to the eviction. They get 70,000 from the public.
Yep.
And the banks claim that back off the Minister for Finance or whatever at a loss to themselves. So they get their money back anyway. They've already been paid for the house. When the bailout happened, they got paid on the insurance for the houses anyway. And then they sold them off to vulture funds, and they get paid again. And now they're coming back after you for more money.
Yeah, no, I mean, the whole scam. And of course, you know, again in Ireland, I'm not too sure about the UK, but over here, as you both know, is that you have the registrar who wears the registrar's hat, and people will go in to be evicted. And of course, she takes the hat off and puts on the sheriff's hat and gets a percentage of the sales or the deal from the eviction.
Right. 7.5%, yeah.
7.5%. I mean, where else would you kind of get that? I mean, talk about a total conflict of interest.
Yeah. We haven't changed much since the times of the famine, only it's our own turning on each other now, really, isn't it?
Well, that's right. I mean, Finbar said that, you know, hence why the National Land League was set up, because the Land League in the 1800s were doing the same thing, except the landlords are now the banks, and the thugs that are coming out are all kind of the security companies that are Irish and being used to evict the people, you know. So it's just amazing. And they feel like, you know, what's wrong with this? I'm just doing my job. I mean, when I hear that, I'm just doing my job. You know, it's just...
Yeah, three years ago, funny, I had a letter, a guy texted me late at night, around midnight, and he had a 7-day letter from the bank, you know, and he thought that he had to get out within 7 days. And I said to him, I said, no bank and no financial institution can tell you to leave your home. It has to be a judge's order, an eviction order. And I just gave him the hub's number, and I didn't hear from him for, it was about 6 months ago, I got an email off him. And it was a real thank you email. Thank you, Dermot. You probably don't remember me. I went to that number you went, and my whole life has turned around. Now I'm dealing with the bank. I went to the hub, and they sorted me out. And that man's whole life changed. But had he given in his house, like a lot of people have, a lot of people just threw in the keys and went off to Australia on the basis of this 7-day letter. And that's what's happening. So if you get a 7-day letter, that's the one you're told to be in, and you go to the hub.
That's why they brought in this amendment to the Land and Conveyancy Act, remember? So it's a fast track through the courts now. Like, people used to be able to talk in the courts. Now, the first thing they think they have to do is get a solicitor to write affidavits, which is where we come in, you know? So, like, it's the whole fear of the system.
Yeah. Well, it's a lack of knowledge, because,
lack of knowledge. Because, let's be honest, unless you're a criminal, most people have never been in a court before.
Exactly.
Like, you have this huge cohort of people who are suddenly being herded like animals through a system that they thought was only for criminals, you know?
Yeah.
And what they're learning then along the way is that no matter what they do, it looks like they're going to lose their home. So half the time they're afraid to put on the heat. We've had somebody who actually told us their ESB bill is €28 and they live with their elderly mother. They're that afraid to turn on lights and the heat trying to pay money. And all the time this bank is coming after them. This bank thinks that they're going to get their house, you know?
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's not living.
This is madness. Dermot.
Yeah, what people have to realise is that if people put the blame on themselves, and they listen to the media hype that we borrowed too much and we done this.
Yeah.
The people didn't do anything wrong. It was the banks that done the crime. They gambled on the market, and there should have been something in the mortgage stipulated. Although it says on the mortgage document, you can lose your home if you fail to keep up payments. There should have been another little clause in there. But if we do something that causes you not to be able to pay, then something should happen. But it was the banks that caused all this problem, not the people. 300,000 people were put straight away onto the dole with the actions of the bank. They gambled on the market, they lost. We had to foot the bill. We lost all, including myself, I lost all my business, my machines, my diggers, everything gone because of what the banks did. And then when I kept paying me mortgage with them, and then I couldn't pay any more because I'd been lost in my job and everything. Then they come and sent me a letter, a 10-day letter 4 years ago that I had to leave my home within 10 days. And then I said, hang on a minute now. You've taken everything from me, you're not taking my home. And that's when I started fighting them. And it was people like the Hub and Claire Cullinane and people like that, Tom Dashie, that helped me in the beginning. And what I learned from all of those, I'm putting out to other people today, you know?
Exactly, and that's what we need to do. We need to educate everybody and give them the knowledge. And I think that's what's happening in Ireland. A lot of people now are realizing that we have to know about the law and we have to understand this system. And what's happened is that because of maybe this whole, you know, the eviction and the bailout and the Irish water fiasco, people are beginning to look into the law and understand that and go, well, hang on a minute. I don't accept that. I want to question that. I want to query that.
Yeah.
And then, so they've made a rod for their own back from what they did.
Well, what I think a lot of people are missing is you want to start educating your children now. Because when I'm in the courts, I notice certain prestigious school boys and girls attend the courts a lot to learn what's going on. And I think it's something that we've always lacked. Teach your children their rights and send them to places to learn how the world works. You know, bring them to the courts sometimes. Let them see things. You see, otherwise what happens is you just perpetuate ignorance. Yeah, the next few decades, you know?
I totally agree, and that's the problem.
Yeah.
You know, I remember, there's a great book out there called Rich Dad, Poor Dad, and it was a fantastic book, and one of the comments that was made in it by the rich dad was that, he said, if your parents are not millionaires, how can they teach you to be a millionaire? They can't. They'll only teach you what they know, and pass it on to you.
Well, if your parents don't understand how life works, you can't understand it either. And the law is very important in life. I'm not saying that the laws are right. I'm not, you know, talking about the laws in particular, but you have to know your rights and know laws and know how to fight them as well, because people forget they have rights.
Exactly.
You know, as Dermot said there a minute ago, people thinking that they're guilty because they borrowed money. Well, no, actually the bondholders are the ones, you know, who caused this problem, and the politicians and bankers.
They need to
feel guilty like they've done something wrong.
Yeah, and they need to realise that. Now, tell us something, Martina, and Dermot, if you want to add to this as well. Just to clarify for people, if people get a 7-day letter or a 10-day letter from the bank, tell us what they have to do.
What they have to do is give us a ring or give Dermot a ring, and we will take it from there. They bring it into us then, and we go through it and look at it and have a chat with them, make them a nice cup of tea or coffee, give them a hug, a little bit of TLC, tell them everything is okay, and hopefully they'll, you know, stick in there.
Okay, what?
And you do not have to get out of your house in 7 days is the answer to that.
Okay, brilliant. What if somebody comes to you and they have a letter saying, they received a letter saying the sheriff's going to be coming and an eviction's going to take place? If they, obviously, you know, first of all, they have to realise is that, I believe, that there has to be a court order signed in blue ink from a judge to make it legit.
Yeah. We've never seen one signed by a judge.
So you've never seen one?
Signed by a judge.
Signed by a judge. But yet they turn up saying that they're going to evict you based on...
Yeah. And they have to be signed by a judge.
Okay.
You evict yourself. You evict yourself when you're walking out of your home. You don't walk out of your home.
Yeah.
And you don't never open the door.
People don't know their rights, yeah.
Okay.
If a sheriff comes to your door, you don't open the door. You go to the top window and you talk to him from there. He cannot break in your door. It's against the Constitution to break in your door.
Okay, because it's a dwelling.
Yeah.
Under the Constitution.
People evict themselves by walking out. They're opening the door and they let the sheriff rush in with his heavies and take the home. So you do not open the door for a start. You just lock the door. Do not open it. Go to the top window. Can I help you? No, I don't want to be evicted today. Goodbye. And let them break the door. If you break the door, you can get the police to seal them then.
Yeah. And another thing, when people are in court, do not ever consent to anything you do not understand, particularly if you are a litigant in person. If a judge or a registrar says to you, do you understand, and you don't, you say, I don't understand. And I do not consent until I find out if I understand. Because, you know, you can be kind of cajoled into answering things through nervousness and not understand, but it is your right to say I don't understand and to get time to go off, find out information about what you don't understand. So people should be aware of that too.
We have a group there called the Anti-Eviction Task Force, which is on the sign. I'll have a sign in the car tomorrow. I have the West Mid Land League on it, the Hub Ireland, and I have the Anti-Eviction Task Force. So if anybody is getting evicted, just go onto my page. The sign is there with the Anti-Eviction Task Force number, you know?
Okay, yeah. And it's okay in court to say to the judge, or if the banker are trying to pull a fast one, say, I object.
Just say, I do not consent because I do not understand, and okay. I want time to find out.
Okay.
I can't afford a solicitor, blah, 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 blah.
That's the legal aid.
Yes, I need to find out because it made such an important decision. You could walk out there and say, what just happened there? And we have found people who've walked out of the court not knowing what happened.
Yeah.
Because first of all, they're traumatised, and when you're traumatised, you cannot take anything in.
No,
ask the court for legal aid. Tell them you want legal aid.
Yeah.
Okay, we have a call coming in. Let's see, we have a listener calling in. Hang on a minute there. Hello, you're on air. Do you have a question for Dermot or Martina?
The Constitution regarding the protection of the house and things like that, you know.
Yeah. Okay, what's your question?
The question is, the Constitution protects, you know, the problem is that the Constitution is not even taught in school. Your Constitution rights are. And the guy was saying about we're being educated, but the problem with that is the only person that can interpret the Constitution is the Minister of America. But yet the Constitution is supposed to be for everyone.
Okay.
The rights are written by the man in 1916,
right? Yeah.
So what they do is it because they want us not to know what our basic rights are, or whether we keep it under the rights, which is not always been basically keeping it under those who can talk to it. Which is, and then the Constitution says you have rights.
It doesn't say you have to pay for the rights. There's a rights. If they tell you your rights, you're going to stand up against them, so they're not going to tell you your rights. You have to find out your rights for yourself. Irish children are not taught politics in school. There's a reason for that. I think they teach them over in France and countries like that, but then in France you wouldn't get away with the things our government get away with. So, yeah, that would be the reason for that, yeah. But so I mean, the little...
I would bring up the Department of Justice, so, like talking to the world.
The
problem there is, and even with legislation, when you ask the government, it goes to the electorate, but it goes also to the Attorney General.
Mm-hmm.
And then who makes a judgment? And then all of a sudden, it's already like even the legislation comes in straight away. But it's not even. The public don't even have an opportunity even to legally challenge it.
No, they don't. And I believe in Canada, when they're discussing new legislation, they'd have like what you're having here. They'd have phone-in programs and they have interactive, on the internet, and people say, well, I don't like this and I'd like that, and that's the way it works over there. Not in Ireland, though, because here's another aspect. You know, you have these banking rules, and when banks are trying to repossess a house, they have to follow certain banking rules, and then these banking rules keep changing along the way, and in my opinion, always to suit the banks. So before you get any further, some new rule comes in, and as long as they comply by it, happy days, they think, for the banks and the courts, you know. So, yeah, I see what this man is saying, all right. The legislation...
Well, let me
pass
this to you.
That's a very good question. I'm going to discuss it. And I think, you know, you guys have this guy called Mark Stevens on.
That's right.
Yeah. You know, Mark had a very good point, and I know there's different angles, but I've done this a few times, and it has worked. Actually proving, and even actually wrong, and I asked him, can you prove to me what you are doing applies to me? Just because somebody says so, and can you prove to me that what you say so, and if it says it's the law, then the law still has to prove it applies to me. Because I don't know what you're doing. And because legislation is in, and it's just like the vote here in Ireland, Now, I voted for a person, but every time I vote a person in, it never gets through. So therefore, the majority gets through, they are supposed to represent me, and then the legislature comes in, which I totally disagree with, the majority that wins. So if I say, oh, my God, well, you could prove to me then that I'm going to be connected to this.
Well, it's mob rule, isn't it, really?
It's absolutely crazy system.
Yeah.
In the Constitution, it clearly states that the man's house is inviolable and cannot be entered into save in accordance with the law. So tell me which law has been broken. What law did I break?
Absolutely. What law did I break? And I asked even the show.
I asked
the or you have to go to the legal term, go to solicitors and then answer the question. So
you don't get money.
So it becomes a legal, see where I'm coming from?
They can't. Well, brilliant. Thanks for calling in. That's much appreciated.
Yeah, thanks very much.
Thanks a lot. Take care of yourself.
Thank you.
Well, that was interesting. Yeah, I mean, yeah, he has a point. I do like Mark Stevens. I have to say, I do like his approach, because his approach is don't go into court and just say, can you show me where the law applies to me just because I'm in the country? And Mark has used that approach, because what he's trying to say, you prove the jurisdiction you have over me, and if you can do that, then we go into court. But until you prove that jurisdiction, we can't do anything.
Exactly, yeah. There was 20 cases last week in Trim with the EBS, and every one of them was struck out because of jurisdiction. They didn't have jurisdiction to be in the court. Now, you see, this is the problem. These 20 people didn't show up. Had any, even two of them people turned up in court to defend their homes, they could have sued the EBS for trauma, distress, by bringing them to court, when they didn't have the jurisdiction to have them in there in the first place.
Yeah.
And this is the other thing.
I mean, there's so many people not turning up. It's frightening.
Yeah, it really is.
You know, it's just unbelievable. And if anybody has had their house taken, they should contact us, because there is a way back. Because particularly if you didn't turn up, it is by default, but you also didn't consent to it. They say you consent by default, but I mean, like Dermot says, there's ways back through everything. You could say that you weren't, well, it's probably true, you were so terrorised, you didn't realise you had rights, etc., etc., you know?
Exactly.
So, yeah, so people really should, you know, start standing up now together, because there's strength in numbers as well.
Well, that's what we got there. We came up with, after that man's suicide 2 weeks ago, I came up with the idea of getting the van. And I have the van outside now, and the sign writer is going to do it this week. And I'm going to have the hub on one side of it, the Westfield Land League on the other, and the anti-eviction.
All the
contact numbers on the van, and the big sign. And I'm going to park outside the square in Tallaght, Blanchardstown Shopping Centre at weekends, and at every court around the Midlands. And I hope that people around the country will get other vans like this going as well, to get the message out to people, you know?
Definitely. I love the van that Ben had when he was doing the 90-second promo for DDI.
Something like that would be great too.
That would be brilliant. Imagine having the hub and the National Land League up there, along with one or two other groups, or, you know, people, and saying, we are here, we're here to help, we can help, and we're trying to... I mean, the one thing, I don't know whether, Dermot, you were there at the launch of the National Land League in the Trim Court, whether you were in the audience. I know Tom Darcy was there and Ben, and then they had to go. And then people were kind of saying, well, how can we get this information now? And nobody mentioned the alternative media, which is us, right? And then I walked up from the audience, I grabbed the microphone, and I said to people, look, there are radio stations out there, like OYM, like PIR, we're trying to get the information out there, and to educate people, have people on like yourself coming on, educating people, and letting people know what's going on. But they just weren't aware of it, and that's we've been running, 5.5 years now, Steve, coming up to nearly 6 years this year. And we're still amazed that people don't realise that there's alternative media radio stations in Ireland who are trying to get the information out there. It's amazing.
Well, that's kind of like the Hub and the Land League. There's people, as Dermot said earlier on, who will turn around and go, I never heard of them. Because we're not meant to be heard of, and neither are you. That's the way the country operates, you know?
Yeah.
The normal people are not to know about us, are you?
Yeah.
When we go to court cases in Mullingar, for instance, every court case, we go to the Westmead topic, the newspaper, which has 50,000 reach, and we put in what happened in the court. There was no evictions, and if anybody's in trouble, contact the hub or contact the Westmead Land League, and our numbers are put in the newspaper, and that's how we're getting the message out to people. But that's only one newspaper. The rest of them won't touch us. The Herald won't touch us.
Yeah.
RTE, well, yeah. I start here, sent them loads of emails, and I said, well, could you just put on your news after 6 o'clock? That's all you have to do, is put on the news after 6 o'clock. That anybody that's turning up in court, there will be people at the court to help you. That's all you have to put on the news.
Well, here's a good one for you, Dermot. We've had referrals from, we'll say, we always kind of try to say to people, where did you hear about it? Because it gives us, you know, a good, it gives us a knowledge about where people are hearing. And people will tell us that frontline services are sending them to us. Like, I can't think of it there at the moment. My mind has gone blank for a second.
Maybe MAPS.
Citizens Advice Bureau. Gardaí. Counselling groups. So, like, the frontline services are not coping, and they don't know where to send people, and they're sending them to us, and we're delighted now, I have to say.
Yeah, well, that's brilliant. I mean, and that people are being sent to you. And again, we're trying to get the information out there regarding the regulations.
Yeah. It's brilliant, but it's also very worrying that frontline services that are supposed to be able to help people and are being paid to help people. I'm not running them down there, but like they are finding that sending people to the supposed channels is not working, so they're therefore sending them to us because
they're really only helping us out there.
Yeah, and like we are the help. The unfunded voluntary groups are the help out there, and that's the end of it, you know. And that's frightening because they're being told send someone to such a place. It's like the doctor sending someone to the hospital, the psychiatric hospital, and there's no beds, you know.
Yeah.
It's the same situation. People are being sent to places, the places can't help them, and then the places are sending the people to us.
And of course, you know, the other thing that we didn't mention about this is the health of the people who are suffering from the stress and everything else.
Oh yeah, dreadful. Yeah.
You know, it's unbelievable. I mean, this is why we kind of advertise, you know, when we have people on, like doctors on the show, or people who are into different methods of treatment, natural methods of treatment, and like the pain genie, helping people. It's because we know that all the stress and all the pain and issues that come with the whole hassle of being threatened that your house is going to be taken off you is phenomenal. Yeah. And it's not just the physical, it's the mental side as well.
Well, do you know what else has been missed?
My own doctor told me just a few months ago that he was really angry. He said these banks, he said, have a lot to answer for. This is from my doctor, a very conservative doctor. He says these banks have a lot to answer for. And I said, why? He said, oh, the amount of people that come in here, he says, they have destroyed families, the fabric of society.
Yeah, well, there's no surprise. I mean, we know how bad the banks are. I mean, if you think about this, and I think I said it on a show a couple of weeks ago, I just hope, well, maybe our grandchildren or our children's children will actually turn around and go, you knew all this was going on, and you let this go on. You actually think the banks, hang on, so our grandchildren will say, so let me get this right, a private company, which is a bank, they made the money, they printed out the money, it wasn't the government, which you'd think the government would control the money and the usury, but you gave it to a private company, which is a bank, and then they took the money from thin air and gave you that, and then they want to charge you interest on that, and you let them do it. You know, I mean, maybe your grandkids will turn around and go, and you let them get away with that? And people didn't see this. They thought this was right.
Well, like, you're just hit on something very important there as well. Children. I mean, God knows what impact this is having on family lives across the country, and particularly young children. You know, it doesn't even bear thinking about. Because if the parents can't cope, how are the kids coping?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. I mean, it is.
You know?
Well, I'll tell you, I want to focus on, we have about 10 minutes left, 10, 15 minutes left, but I want to focus on the good side. And number one, I want to focus on the great work that the Hub are doing and the great work that the National Land League are doing with Dermot and his team there, because this is all voluntary. You're putting your own energy in and obviously using your own money at times, I'm pretty sure you are, like myself and Steve do. Now, a big thank you to people that donate to OAM Radio. You know who you are, who help us out. But we do put our own money into OYM as well, because, you know, we can't fund it completely out of the donations. But we do it because we have a moral conscience, as I'm sure guys do. So give us some good stories that you actually dealt with, and which turned out quite well, or turned out very well.
Well, we've beaten the sheriff 60 times, so that in itself speaks volumes.
That's 60 times, 60.
We have a lot of people who I would call had personality transplants since they came into the hub, came in one way and went out completely another, and now help out when they can, and are still in their homes. And people who have begun to live again and to take back their lives, because they weren't living lives before they came in to see us.
I was in Mullingar at Christmas time, and a guy came up and he walked straight up to me and shook my hand. And I remembered his face, and he said, "My God," he said, "Dermot, I would have never believed 4 years ago that I'd be in my home today, because he owned the hub." You know, this guy came into our, we started off the Westmead Land League of Mullingar about 4 years ago. Well, it wasn't the Westmead Land League, it was a group that we started off, and we started doing, we got sued our banks and different things. And this guy came in, he had taken all his pictures down off the wall, he had all the boxes packed and all, and he was leaving his home. And he just came in to the hotel lobby where we are meeting, because he couldn't afford to get a room. And I said to him, "What are you taking all your stuff down for?" He says, "Oh, well, they're going to get those out." And I says, "No," I says, "challenge them in the court." And he stayed with us, and he just shook my hand there at Christmas. He said, "I never believed that I'd be in my home for the millennium, you know, for 2016.
Yeah.
For the walk in the hub. I sent the walk to the hub afterwards, you know. And that man is still in his house. And I've loads and loads of people like that. And so one day when I meet you, I'll show you the text I got at Christmas from people. And the hub got the same.
That's
thanking us for being in our homes, you know, for Christmas.
No, that's brilliant. I think we have a couple of questions there, Steve.
Yes, we have a question there from Chris. Chris asked this earlier, and he wants to know, if a bank accepts surrender documents signed under duress, does that remove their jurisdiction?
How do you mean signed under duress?
I think Chris was being harassed, and he was told that he needed
anything,
to sign.
Anything that's signed under duress is not admissible in court.
Yeah.
Because it's gone under duress, so you weren't compos mentis when you signed it, you know?
Yeah.
Well, Chris would be better off, if he really feels that way, having a chat with his doctor to see where he was at that time. Was he getting any help medically or anything like that? Because all these things add up in a courtroom, you know, if you can show that you were under duress, of course.
Yeah.
I mean,
well,
you know.
Chris goes on to say, actually, on a different note, he says he told the bank's solicitor that his family address is private property, and if they wish to carry out business on my private property without written permission, this incurs a charge of €10,000. And he says they haven't tried to serve any papers on him since.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah, very interesting.
We actually heard, well, there was something going around there about a month and a half ago, and it caught my attention, and I sent it over to one of my ex-neighbours in Brazil.
Yeah.
And it was someone saying, again, I don't know if this is kind of, if it's been tested, or if it's just, you know, pogwash or hugwash or whatever the hell it's called, hogwash. There was something saying that if you can't afford to pay your mortgage and the bank won't work with you, which is exactly what happened with my neighbour, the bank wouldn't work with him. He tried to put something in place and they wouldn't accept it. So he walked away from the home and posted the keys back to him. Now, we seen something there recently saying that if you'd done that, if you felt that that's what you had to do, that all monies that you had paid to the bank since the mortgage was signed would need to be returned to you. Is that something you've come across?
I would ask him to go and see, was he offered a cooling off period, because that's one of the things that we came across. Banks were supposed to offer a cooling off period of 10 days and didn't.
Yeah. Well, now he was in the home for about 10 years.
Right, yeah.
And he was paying the mortgage.
Yeah, well, I mean, tell him to come in and see us.
He's in Brazil.
He's in Brazil at the moment.
Oh, he's in Brazil. That's email.
I'll pass on the details. And
I know. I mean, we have people who do ring from abroad.
Yeah. And that's the question.
Because an awful lot of people ran out of the country. They had no choice. They couldn't make a living.
Exactly. You know? Well, the question that Steve just said there, I sent the information over to Byron. Because we got that information, and basically it was all got to do with European law and the fact that the banks did what they did. They didn't tell us about the 10-day cooling off period, and that if you decide after a period of time that as a contract that you don't want to contract anymore, or something in the law that says you get all your monies back.
An EU directive,
and that was an EU directive, and I think Byron is now looking into that or making a challenge on that at the moment. Hence why we, you know, getting Byron on, it would have been good to talk to him about that.
There was a challenge at Trim Court last week about it.
Go ahead, Dan.
There was a guy in Trim Court just last week about this.
Okay.
And he had cancelled his contract with the bank. So when the bank came into court, the first thing they said was they wanted an adjournment. And he stood up and he said, "Your Honour, I don't want an adjournment because I've cancelled my contract. There is no case to be heard before the court." And the judge, Reynolds, he just sort of looked and said, you'll have to put a submission in, a motion to that effect. Because he adjourned the case for 2 weeks and put a motion in to the effect of that, you know?
Oh, okay. That's going to be interesting to find out.
There's a few of them before the courts already, you know?
Well, that's brilliant. And this is what's happening, and this is the great thing, that because of the way the banks are, they're getting people to go and examine the law and look at the law and challenge the law. So, that, again, they're making a rod for their own back because of what they're doing.
Well, I've always said it from the very start, and I've put a couple of posters about this. The banks, in a way, done us a favour because they put 300,000 of us on the dole. Building workers like myself, digger drivers, this, that, and the other. And we've nothing else to do except get a laptop and start questioning and looking and learning. And they created a rod for their own back because we started to study their laws. And we started to study where they went wrong. We started in liquidity, fractional reserve banking, different things like that. And then we bumped into the negotiation of contracts right in the business premises. So we're tackling them with their own laws. So in effect, they've done us a great favour by putting us out on the ball.
And another thing as well, as disappointing as the elections might have been, there's still a great optimism, I think, because a lot of people who were now, it was a very short time for new people to get themselves out there. But they were getting themselves out there. I think the government have an awful lot to fear for the next election. You know,
they definitely have.
It was just too short a period this time. They didn't have the exposure that the main parties had. That's all it is, though.
Everybody was all down yesterday about the elections, and I was feeling really good. I said, this is great. For the first time in history, the ordinary people have destroyed the Labour Party. Destroyed them.
Absolutely. It's a huge, huge, huge big thing to have done it, you know?
And I think that the fact that we have, we know that they're going to be in for another 5 years, but they might not be. Well, I was going to say, they've given us 5 years to wake up more people, so when the election comes around again, we might decimate them completely.
And not only that, but we're going to make them accountable now, because we're not just going to take it anymore. We're going to make them accountable, we're going to call on them, we're going to direct them to their duties.
And
the money that they get paid.
And what about the likes of the TDs? Can we not kind of approach them and say, well, you have a duty of care because you've been elected to actually take care of us
be
a representative?
And that's what we have to start doing, Because you saw the lead up to the elections, how many of them were challenged out on the streets and they didn't like it.
Yeah.
And just because they get elected and there's a new government, that doesn't mean that they get off the hook either, you know?
They've signed up for the one-year initiative. A lot of them signed up for the one-year initiative, so
and we do need a bit of work with the Constitution, making it more democratic for people to get involved in, you know, that thing about the Article 48.
I just don't understand the accounting, the election system, and how they do the counting. You know, I suppose they, you know, if you're 1, 2, 3, they have to go back and do it. You know, it just seems to be...
Well, again, that's the Irish mentality. What we allow will continue. But maybe that's something that we have to start working on now and making a different approach.
Yeah.
And making sure that there's impartial people from all walks of society in the next electorate hall.
And
we have to push for internet voting where you have your IP address, everybody has a unique
IP address. That's another thing as well. They did spend a fortune bringing in electronic voting. Do you remember that?
Listen,
we're still paying the rent on those, aren't we?
Yeah, we are paying the rent.
Exactly.
But look, I can tell you now, electronic voting because a guy stood up, a programmer in Florida, and said they can be rigged. And internet voting, I can spoof your IP address, Dermot, and pretend it's you, spoof. If you're using electronics, look, I know we think the current system is not good, but it's a manual system. If you go into electronics, I can guarantee you'll be manipulated very easily.
That is true,
so you have to be careful. But look, we've reached that time of the evening. Again, thanks a lot for coming on and jumping in for Byron, Martina, and Dermot. Thanks a lot for coming on and doing what you're doing. And I want, again, to for Dermot and Martina, both of you to tell us all about what you're doing and how people can contact you. So over to Dermot first.
Well, you can contact, I'm on Facebook, Dermot Murphy on Facebook, or you can contact the Westmead Land League. If you go onto Facebook, you'll see the sign that I'm going to have in the court tomorrow. All the numbers will be on there. Or else you can get me through the hub. Brian has and Martina have my number, you know.
Yeah.
Brilliant. And Martina, if you want to tell us about how you
We're
contact
the hub.
We're in the
hub, 21 Little Mary Street. It's just off Cashel Street there. You know, if anyone knows Slattery's Pub and the AIB on Capel Street, there's a little street called Mary Street Little in the middle there, and we're in number 21. And the phone number is 01-534-9118. Or you can email info@thehub-ireland.com.
Okay, and if sorry, go ahead.
I was just going to finish off by saying that don't forget tomorrow, around the country, there is a load of eviction cases taking place. So if people would turn up at their local court. I have got the figures here somewhere, but I can't manipulate the phone to read them out. But I know Trim, Mullingar, Dublin, the usual places. And,
you know, it just means,
if you go on the Facebook, you'll see it on the Hub page or Dermot's page. Now, the thing is, you know, if people just sometimes appreciate somebody putting their arm on them saying, it's okay, everything is going to be okay, because they can be rigid with fear. They don't know what's happening and they are terrified they're going to be thrown out of their house any day, you know. So even just to turn up and support people and, you know, just tell them you're there for them and direct them either our way or to Dermot or to both.
Excellent. And so, how can people donate, Martina, if they want to, you know, help out and make a donation to the Hub?
If you go on the Hub Facebook page, it'll give you all that information. And any money that is donated goes directly to paying the ESB bill, internet charges, and just basically keeping the place going. There's also funds for certain different things, people in extremely dire circumstances. So we keep all our accounts on the wall for all we have. And basically, that's where the money goes.
Brilliant. And Dermot, is there a donation button for yourselves?
No, we don't have a donation as such. When we get people in to help out, there's a box on the table, and if they're not walking, they've no money, it's okay. If you have a fiver to put in, it's okay. We don't ask people for money.
We're the same as well. We'd never ask anyone for money.
Okay.
And anyone who ever asks for money in our name is not with the Hub.
Yeah.
Just to put that out there.
And of course, it's obviously donations as well, like all of us.
Absolutely.
No problem at all. Well, listen, guys, thanks a lot for coming on. Much appreciated. I think we did know all the details, and we got all the...
You have the details, yeah?
I have all the details there. Brilliant. Yeah. Okay, we're just going off to a musical break, and we'll be back after. Just stay with us there.
This is Open Your Mind Radio on OYMRadio.com, UnitedWeStrike.com, and PeoplesInternetRadio.com.
Okay, and we're back. Yes, great information there, and thanks to everyone who commented on both of the chat rooms there in relation to the information coming across from Dermot and from Martina. Again, the Hub, 21 Little Mary Street, as Martina said. The phone number is 01-534-9118. If you have any spare change that you need to, you know, put to a good cause, or know that it's going to be used, you know, wisely, I'm sure the Hub or Dermot with the Westmead Land League could do it, all donations. And they don't have $250,000 in the bank, as was mentioned earlier. But great information, and I say thanks to everyone who put in some lovely positive comments as well. Martina was just saying to us during the break there that she was it was her first time doing the interview. She hasn't really done interviews before, so she hoped she came across okay.
And she just wanted to remind people that if they feel that they're going to walk away from the house, that the residual debt, the banks will go after you for that as well. They won't ignore it. They'll chase you for that. Where in America, when there's a foreclosure, you can walk away and that's it. But over here in Ireland, no, we don't let you off with that. We'll chase you for the extra debt, for the residual debt, the outstanding debt on the property. So just bear that in mind. So I think it's worth fighting. Definitely worth fighting. And I just hope that we can get the word passed around with alternative media and the Hub and the likes of the National Land League. I mean, Ben had a great van, and they were driving around the van, and they had this big LCD screen, and it was the 90-second party political broadcast that was being played over and over again, and it would park up, people would see it, and then the van would move on. And that would be fantastic if you had the National Land League, the Hub, OYM Radio, PIR, and just letting people know that we're all there, and we're all trying to do our bit. All volunteers, not getting paid, but we're all trying to do our bit to try and wake the country up, wake people up, and get them to realise that, number one, there is help out there. Number two, we are trying to get the information out to people, to educate people about what's going on. that's all we can do. That's all we can do. But a brilliant interview, great information. Again, if you're stuck, and it doesn't have to be an eviction, by the way. If you are in a financial debt with the Hub, you can give them a ring. Whether it's the property charge, or whether it's the Irish Water, or whether it's credit cards, just give the Hub a ring and speak to them, and I'm sure they'll be able to help you out in some way. And there's multiple sites out there as well, like getoutdebtfree.org. I think you posted that up, Steve. Did you post that up?
We had it up there before, getoutdebtfree.org. It's a getoutofdebtfree.org. It's a fantastic website if you're struggling, or if you know someone who is struggling and they need guidance. Maybe they don't want to reach out to the likes of the Hub, they don't want to speak about it, but if they just want some information without actually speaking to another human being, there's a lot of great information can be gleaned from that particular website there, with sample letters as well, and a kind of a step-by-step process showing you what you can do and how to go about it. So getoutofdebtfree.org, check it out.
Brilliant stuff. And now next week we have, of interest, we have a Dr. Martin Powell, and we're going to be talking about the dangers of Wi-Fi and EMF technology. Now, Dr. Martin Powell can categorically confirm now that wireless technology, Wi-Fi and the like, anything over 300 megahertz is dangerous. He can confirm it now. It's science. It's confirmed. And there was a doctor in, there was an article in The Guardian over in the UK by some prominent physician saying that, oh yes, no, this won't cause harm, etc., etc. So what I did was I sent the link over to Dr. Martin Powell and a colleague of his, another doctor, and Dr. Peter over in Denmark. I think they're in Denmark. Oh no, Germany, sorry. And Dr. Peter and Dr. Martin got back to me and said, this guy is basically incorrect. He doesn't know what he's saying. So just in case people did see the article regarding that Wi-Fi and the like is safe, well, ignore it, because Dr. Martin Powell has the real information. And he's going to be on next week. We're going to be talking to Dr. Martin about that. And again, it's just more confirmation. So if you know anybody suffering from hyperelectric sensitivity, get them to tune in next week on the show, because more and more people are beginning to suffer from this. And it's not psychological. People are suffering from it. They were trying to say that it's all psychological and it's in the head. Well, it's not. People are suffering from this. We've already had people on the show talking about this and saying about their experiences. So, sorry, that's my...
what is that noise?
That's my Facebook. It's going off. Sorry. Do you hear that? Is it quite loud? Yeah, okay.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
The neighbours are complaining.
The neighbours, it is quite loud, actually. Yeah, okay, you'll have to turn that down. But yeah, Dr. Martin Powell on next week. But there you go. So, it was great to be back in the studio, 4 weeks away since the two of us were actually in the studio together.
Yep.
But we managed, and we sorted it out, and we dealt with it, and, you know, everything else.
I don't know if people are picking that up, but, wow, Facebook.
Yeah,
I didn't realise Facebook had those little jingles associated with it.
Oh, well, here's the thing.
Sound effects or whatever.
That sound didn't work a few weeks ago. I didn't have that sound on. And then one day I logged into Facebook, and all of a sudden when the message came up, it went bing, bing. And I thought, oh, yeah. I didn't ask for that.
Yeah, I think there is something on Facebook whereby you had to accept some. I think they've changed more privacy things as well. So maybe they just enabled it by default. Yeah. You wouldn't know. Okay. You wouldn't know what they were up to.
One of the things, one of our listeners is going to be paying a visit to us in a couple of weeks' time. You know who you are, visitor. You're on the chat room. And I'll say visitor is a listener. Is going to be calling into us, and we're hoping that we're going to be able to, thanks to his skill set and his offer, we're going to be rebuilding the studio technology, the way it's set up at the moment. We're changing everything around, and we're going to hopefully make it easier, but we can add a bit more equipment in and have it a bit easier to get a certain things, because it's not as easy getting to the desk where we want to kind of play around with buttons or make changes and stuff like that.
Plus, so this rusty bucket that I have to sit on every week, will that be getting upgraded as well?
Yeah, we'll get you a bigger bucket. I think you need a bigger bucket.
Even a plastic one to do.
Yeah, I don't know. I think you're. Yeah, I think. Well, again, you know, the studio has changed tremendously, both Studio One and Studio Two over the years, and it's all down to the listeners making donations and liking what we do and believing what we do. And you know, we always say it. You know, 5.5 years down the line, we are just two guys with two microphones getting people on the show and just talking about the world and what's going on. And we don't have any other illusions of grandeur than what you hear. We are just two guys, and after we finish the radio show, we just go back to doing what we do. Steve goes back to work, I'm a house husband, and I go back and do what I do.
We
and,
both, you know, put our daddy hats back on as well.
Our daddy hats go on again, and that's the way it is. And, you know, we the feedback that we got from listening to people, when I was down in Dingle, I met a few people that listened to the show, and that's exactly what they said. They said they liked the show because there's nowhere as a crisis. We don't have any alternative motive. The only agenda that we do have, and yes, we do have an agenda, and the agenda is to wake people up to what's going on, and we try and do that one show at a time every week. It's trying to wake people up. That's the plan of attack. So if people say, oh, I am having an agenda, we do. It's to wake people up. That's the plan. So we can stop what's going on in the world and hopefully make a better place by education and learning, and from everybody on there, learning from our guests. That's the plan. Anyway, for myself, Alan James, take it easy, have a good week, stay safe. If you have any information, let us know, and we'll see you next week. Take care.
Okay, and a great show again. Thanks to Martina and also to Dermot. I'm sure we'll have them on again at a later stage to get a catch up and hear what's been happening. So yeah, I'm not too sure who's on with Vin. If you're listening to on the PIR stream, stay tuned for Vin. If you're listening on the OYM stream, we're going to be terminating very, very shortly, and we'll catch you all again next week, same time, same channel. So until then, take care. We love you loads. Bye bye.